I'm Dr. Sam Yanuck. This is Self Tissue Response, Key Insights for Clinical Success. We want to talk today about genomic implications in clinical practice. There are some very, very important ways that different patients are very, very different based on their genetic, epigenetic manifestations in a way that really informs the clinician in deeply important ways about what parts of the case may be more deeply baked in and may require more attention, more persistent influence that may require some escalation in the efforts that you're making in terms of how you're addressing those factors in the case. Having information that gives you an insight about the pattern that involves in a given patient is enormously important in a lot of cases, especially cases that have some complexity. So this is something you want to think about in all your patients, especially something you want to think about in cases that have some complexity. Here are my disclosures. I'm a paid medical advisor for Pure Encapsulations. I'm CEO and Director of Education for Cogens LLC. So, patient individuality. A lot of this that we're going to talk about today has to do with the production of cytokines. These are the signaling chemicals that white blood cells use to talk to each other. Cytokines also arise from other kinds of tissue that we don't normally think of as immune-oriented tissue, but that's part of the realization that so much of biology involves immunological underpinnings. Even things like the extracellular matrix in tissue gives off various kinds of cytokines. Bone, muscle, fat, liver, kidneys, all these kinds of tissues are involved in the signaling cytokine orchestration of function. And knowing the particulars about a patient's tendency in relation to what kinds of cytokines they may be over or under producing from a genetic and epigenetic point of view turns out to be enormously important. So the cytokines signal receptors on various kinds of white blood cells and so on. And so you want to think of a cytokine and its receptor as a signaling system. Efficiencies of production of that cytokine, be they too much or too little, efficiencies of the receptor's sensitivity to cytokine, or how many receptors there are, be it too much or too little. All of that together determines the efficiency of a particular cytokine signaling system. So, just as I said, net efficiency is the cytokine and its receptor. So, if there's highly efficient signaling in a problematic cytokine and its receptor, let's say something that signals for a greater extent of inflammatory activation or a greater extent of a particular kind of T-cell polarization, you need to work harder, you may need to work harder, to get that under control, harder than you would if the patient did not have that kind of epigenetic expression. So, two themes are particularly worthy of our attention today. One is Th17 cell-mediated autoimmunity. This is the way that tissue destruction is driven in the autoimmune process. We're going to be interested in genetic, epigenetic manifestations in that regard. And Th2 cell-mediated allergies, food sensitivities, mast cell activation, dysbiosis, and the dysfunction of hollow spaces, all of that kind of stuff is an indication that the person has a dominance of their Th2 system, too much efficiency in their Th2 system. It may require working harder to downregulate that. So, a lot of what goes on in the immune system has to do with the regulation of biological processes by T cells. And the different kinds of T cells do different things. And so when a person has too much of a tendency to go in one direction, make too many, let's say, Th2 cells, for example, or Th17 cells, then you're going to have problems with an overemphasis of that program immunologically. all the different kinds of T cells, all the different kinds of cytokines, they're all just fine. There's no problem with any of them when biology is normal. They all do things that are useful. But when you have an overemphasis on one instead of the others, then you can have a problem. So if you think of it, let's say, as a baseball team, and you've got four shortstops and no first baseman, because you're overemphasizing one kind of function over another, then you've got dysfunction. Or if you have an orchestra and you have 12 trumpets and two flutes, then your orchestra is out of balance. So there's nothing wrong with shortstops or first basemen or flutes or trumpets. It's just a question of balance or imbalance, regulation or dysregulation. So here you have a dendritic cell. A dendritic cell is the kind of cell that hangs out in tissue, samples things in tissue, and goes to a lymph node, and it's going to present a fragment of what it found in the tissue. It's going to present that to a naive T cell, a T cell that hasn't decided what kind of T cell it's going to grow up and become. Now, the dendritic cell is going to signal that naive T cell using some cytokines, that row of signaling chemicals you see there, and depending upon what kind of cytokine it presents to that naive T cell, that determines what kind of T cell that naive T cell is going to become. The T cell then is going to start making those effector cytokines that you see in that row there, and the effector cytokines are the ones that will drive the various functions. So if you have a dendritic cell that's going to signal that naive T cell with interleukin 4, the naive T cell is going to become a Th2 cell. The Th2 cell is going to make all of these cytokines that are going to drive all of these functions. So the fundamental thing then is what kind of cytokines are being emphasized and perhaps overemphasized is going to determine what kind of T cell pattern you're going to end up overemphasizing. And that's going to lead to a lot of mischief that you'll see every day in chronic illness. The things that we're talking about here are things that your patients that are already in your practice are already experiencing. This is happening every day. Question is, are you recognizing it? And I want to help you work on recognizing these things so you know what to do. Okay, so here's the dendritic cell. Here's that T cell. Now you notice this is a paper from 2003, but the diagram still is the best one I've seen in a research paper for explaining the basic mechanism. Now the dendritic cell is going to hand that fragment of whatever it sampled in the tissue, that's an antigen, it's going to hand that antigen to the T cell. And there are two questions. Is the dendritic cell going to tell the T cell, hey, you should tolerate, here's a fragment of something, you should tolerate it, because after all, it's just a fragment of your own damaged tissue. I cleaned up the tissue, there were some fragments of dead cells and things, I'm handing this to you, but just tolerate it, don't worry about it. Or is the dendritic cell saying to the T cell, you should kill this because I found some bacteria and this is a piece of bacterial fragment. You ought to multiply yourself into a million T cell army, go back to the tissue, find every instance of this bacterial fragment that you find and kill everything there that is the bacteria. So tolerate or kill is the first question. Second question is, what kind of T cell should this one become? Depending upon, is it bacteria that you found in a hollow space? Is it bacteria in solid tissue? Is it a parasite? What kind of thing is going on here? That's going to determine whether that dendritic cell is going to signal with one or another kind of cytokine. Now you can see here, if there's a tendency in a given patient to have an overabundance or an overemphasis of a certain kind of cytokine signaling, you may get an unsuitable signal if that person has an overdetermined tendency toward a certain kind of signal being sent all the time. Now, one of the keys here is that you've got these pattern recognition receptors on the dendritic cells. When those pattern recognition receptors get stimulated by pathogen-associated molecular patterns, structures on, for example, gram-negative bacteria like LPS, when those PRRs get stimulation, the dendritic cell now thinks that there's a pathogen involved. And so the dendritic cell is going to stimulate CD28 on that T cell, and that tells the T cell, hey, this dendritic cell is telling me we're working with a pathogen here. Therefore, whatever that antigen is, I need to kill it. That's the main thing. Now, the other thing is, if this pattern recognition receptor gets stimulation, then the dendritic cell is going to stimulate this Th1 polarizing receptor. You're going to get a Th1 response. Or if it's a different pattern recognition receptor that recognizes different kind of pathogen, then you're going to get this other receptor stimulation, and you'll have that T cell turn into a Th2 cell. So this is mechanistically what's going on. You can see right away how important these cytokines are to the T cell polarization process in this conversation between the dendritic cell and the T cell. You can also see how you can make errors where the dendritic cell may sample a fragment of self tissue, let's say damaged intestinal lining or damaged, you know, joint lining. And if there's also an infection, then even though that antigen is self tissue, if a pattern recognition receptor got stimulation, like with dysbiosis, then you've got pattern recognition receptor giving a kill signal, and you've got cytokines instructing for a T cell polarization pattern, and you've got the antigen being self tissue. Now you can see how you develop autoimmune disease. Okay. So this is Nature Immunology 2017, the multiple pathways to autoimmunity. And what you've got here in a lymph node, that thing in the middle is a lymph node. You can see the DC is the dendritic cell. You have an activated T cell, an activated B cell. That's at the center of things. Now they call out, right, here's the lymph node. They call out specifically that dysbiosis can drive the promotion of Th17 cells, which we're going to see drive autoimmunity. You see the up arrow next to Th17, also more inflammation, and the down arrow next to Tregs. That's regulatory T cells that keep everything quiet. So with dysbiosis, you'll tend to drive a problematic Th17 response. Now, interferon type 1 is not the same thing as interferon gamma. Type 1 interferons are involved in the innate immune response. Interleukin 17 is a Th17 cytokine, and dysbiosis is going to drive those things in the lymph node. Meanwhile, tissue damage, whether it's sterile or infectious, but especially with infection, for the reasons I just mentioned, can be a promoter of autoimmunity. You have more self-antigen with tissue damage. In other words, more fragments that have to get cleaned up that the immune system is going to be possessing because the immune system is cleaning up. You're going to have more self-antigen presentation to T cells by those dendritic cells. You're going to have more inflammation. You're going to have fewer regulatory T cells, more inflammation, more follicular T helper cells. That's a story for another day. In females, you'll have less tolerance. You'll have greater immune response. If you've got less tolerance, you see the those are regulatory T cells. They quiet things down. You'll have fewer of those in females. And you see these green arrows that are blocking arrows. They should be quieting the whole thing down. Less of that response means greater likelihood of this process going forward. And all of this combination together, all the different parts of this, determine the extent to which you're going to end up with these autoimmune processes like inflammatory bowel disease, type 1 diabetes, MS, RA, lupus, and so on. So this is Nature Immunology 2016. And they're saying essentially a pretty simple thing. If you have apoptosis of infected host cells, apoptosis is programmed cell death. So if cells are dying because they're infected, and you have inflammation, and if cells are dying because they're infected, you're going to have inflammation, right? If you've got that circumstance, that's enough to generate autoreactive Th17 cells. Autoreactive means reacting against your own tissue. So, self-reactive Th17 cells promote autoinflammation and autoantibody generation. Those are two different things. Autoinflammatory diseases are things like gout, Mediterranean fever, and so on. Autoantibody generation, that's autoimmunity. And as I've discussed in other lectures, autoimmunity and autoinflammatory disease are deeply connected to each other. Autoinflammatory stuff is related to things like the NLRP3 inflammasome and so on. People with vitiligo as an autoimmune disease have a lot of autoinflammatory component, for example. Okay, so the clinical pearl is that once you've got self-reactive Th17 cells, once the immune system has learned to target a self-tissue target, you do not need the initial trigger anymore. And eliminating the trigger, getting rid of the infection, doesn't get rid of the autoimmune process. You'll often see in, for example, PANS or PANDAS, that there's a notion that the patient must still have an infection, the instigating infection, like the strep if it's PANDAS. There's a notion that says they must still have strep because, after all, they're still having PANDAS symptomatology. And that is not correct. It's not the case that the infection still needs to be there. A person can have an autoimmune flare activation in a way that has nothing at all to do with what initially triggered it. Okay, why is inflammation important in autoimmune process? So there are two roles. The first thing is that, as I just said, programmed cell death of infected host cells plus an inflammatory tissue environment is going to yield you antigen presentation and signaling error, and you'll get autoimmunity. Second reason is there's a whole host of things that we're familiar with in the functional medicine world and functional medicine process, all of which have the potential to be inflammatory. And when you're inflamed, the NF kappa B of the inflammatory process and the STAT3 of the autoimmune process drive each other's activation. STAT3, signal transducer and activator of transcription 3, is what turns naive T cells into Th17 cells. STAT3 is what the differentiation cytokines of the Th17 cell response. It's what gets turned on when interleukin 6 and interleukin 23 stimulate the genes in that naive T cell so that that naive T cell remakes itself as a Th17 cell. Once you've got STAT3 activation, you're off to the races with your Th17 cells and your tissue destruction. And so, for example, going back to that PANDAS example, when you have a patient with PANDAS, if they have blood sugar dysregulation, or if they have very high stress, or if they have a hypoxic experience, they go to Peru and they go to 9,000 feet elevation, or even just they go to Denver and they become marginally, by some decrement, hypoxic, or if they overtrain and pour out a giant amount of interleukin 6, or if they get insomnia so that they dump their Th1 response, they can't get adequate Th1 response, or they can't make enough growth hormone because they can't get enough deep sleep. All of these things have nothing to do with infection, but could nonetheless drive this cascade of autoimmune flare activation. So again, it's not about the trigger always. What made the autoimmune process start in the first place could be historical only and not involved in the current flare. So NF-kappa B, this is the famous first sort of initial review from New England Journal of Medicine talking about NF-kappa B. So it's a 25-year-old paper, but still quite important based on what they describe. So a bunch of inflammatory processes, things like extracellular ATP from other cells dying, for example, drive NF-kappa B activation in the cytosol. The NF-kappa B goes into the nucleus of the cell, lands on the genes, causes expression of a bunch of inflammatory cytokines. Chief among those are TNF-alpha and IL-1 beta, and they reactivate NF-kappa B, and that's why the authors of this paper describe it as the amplifying loop of the inflammatory process. But what if the paper has a gain of function? What if a patient has a gene defect that is a gain-of-function gene defect for TNF-alpha? Wouldn't that spin up this loop more and make it harder to suppress the loop, right? So it becomes crucial to think about NF-kappa-B as an inflammatory driver, but you can't think about NF-kappa-B without thinking about TNF-alpha and IL-1-beta. And then the key insight there, again, is that the NF-kappa-B of the inflammatory process is a co-activator with the STAT3 of the autoimmune, Th17-mediated autoimmune process. Okay, now, what about hollow space dysfunction? Why do we care about that? Okay, Nature reviews gastroenterology and hepatology. Just going to expand the diagram here so we can see it a little better. So here you have Th2 cells in the lamina propria of the intestine, right? So at the top, you see inside the lumen, you have your microbiota and so on. And then that green row is your epithelial lining. And when you have inflammation and your epithelial lining, you promote Th2 activation. The Th2 cells make IL-5 that drives eosinophil activation, and IL-4 that drives mast cell activation. The mast cells make histamine. Now, the histamine and the eosinophil granule proteins drive enteric nervous system neurons. They send signals to the brain. Inflammatory cytokines in circulation, like IL-1-beta, TNF-alpha, IL-6, and again, what if the patient has gain-of-function defects for those? Those cytokines also stimulate the brain. All of that stimulation drives a stress response that drives macrophages to become M2 macrophages, and it drives naive T cells to become Th2 cells. So this is a big time loop activation between the chemistry of stress and the Th2 response and the re-stimulation of the brain that perpetuates the chemistry of stress. So in patients with dysbiosis and in patients with high histamine levels and in patients with high stress, those things will all kind of bake each other in. And the extent to which that entrenchment is present will be deepened when there's gain of function for any of the parts of this picture. Notice that the stimulus toward that Th2 dominance is noradrenaline, and same thing for the M2-MEC. Noradrenaline, norepinephrine, same thing, just depends if you're in the US or the UK. Okay, so that's going to give you your picture of Th2 dominance in your dysbiotic patient or in your stressed patient who then becomes dysbiotic. You can start this process from any point in the loop. Now, Nature Reviews Immunology 2018, here's a dendritic cell. You notice that it's reaching its dendrite up between epithelia in a way that doesn't require leaky gut. So the immune system is sampling antigens in the lumen of the intestine, whether you have leaky gut or not. It's not about leaky gut as a requirement for sampling. So that antigen is going to get handed to a T cell. This is likely to become a Th2 cell, especially when there's a context of inflammatory process in the intestinal lining. Now, the intestinal epithelia make IL-25, IL-33, and TSLP, and these will drive innate lymphoid cells type 2. You notice they also hand antigenic fragments to Th2 cells. And these innate lymphoid cells type 2 do some very important things. One thing they do that we're not going to cover today, but I'll just mention, is that innate lymphoid cells type 2 drive myeloid-derived suppressor cells to make copious amounts of transforming growth factor beta. And TGF-beta drives fibrosis, drives an enormous production of reactive oxygen species. That creates a lot of oxidative stress. It depletes the body's glutathione, creates a lot of inflammation. There's a ton of mischief that goes on there. So in lab testing, when you measure TGF-beta and you see it high, you can think about this kind of mechanism. The innate lymphoid cells type 2 and the Th2 cells together create all of these other Th2 promoting cytokines. The IL-5 drives the eosinophils, the IL-4 and IL-9 drive mast cell activation. We're going to talk about IL-9 later. And then IL-4 and 13 drive M2 macrophages, and IL-4 drives B cell production of IgE. Now, the IL-9 driving mast cells is pretty important because that's part of how you get this rapid Th2 reaction. Because you got to say to yourself, okay, patient eats a food that they're reacting to, could they make a new batch of Th2 cells as rapidly as they respond? What you're seeing sometimes is simply a lot of innate lymphoid cell type 2 activity, because ILC2s can react really quickly compared to how quickly you can make a new batch of Th2 cells. You notice also they call out Th1 and Th2 as reciprocally inhibitory. They also call out basophils as drivers of Th2 activation, you just saw there. Okay, now this is a delightful paper from Allergy 2020, IL-25, 33, and CSLP, pushing Th2 dominance and type 2 inflammation. Type 2 inflammation is another way of saying Th2 dominance-based inflammation. So here, they're talking about the lungs, but you notice epithelia are epithelia. Lining cells in hollow spaces, lungs, sinuses, intestines, vaginal tract, bladder, they're all hollow spaces lined with epithelia, and the theme across all of them is quite similar. So here you have pathogens, air pollutants, chemicals, things that a person might breathe in. Ozone you would put in that category too. So bad ozone day in the summer, expect your autoimmune patients who have this kind of mechanism going on to do worse. So the epithelia make IL-25, IL-33, and TSLP. First thing to notice is you're going to get mast cell degranulation just from the epithelial inflammation and those cytokines. You're not even talking yet about a Th2 response. You're going to get the mast cell degranulation. You're going to get more mast cells and they're going to degranulate. So greater numbers and more degranulation. You're going to get dendritic cells signaling T cells to become Th2 cells. And you're going to make these innate lymphoid cells type 2. Now, the Th2 cells and innate lymphoid cells type 2 will make IL-5. That's going to drive eosinophilia. Notice, by the way, on a CBC with differential Y count, the normal percentage of eosinophils is, what do you think it is? Do you think it's 3%? That's the common answer. The normal is 0 or 1% because eosinophils have no housekeeping function. Normal is 0 or 1%, but it's so common to find patients that are Th2 dominant because we live in a polluted, stressed environment where we're looking at blue screens all the time. Our food isn't as nutritive as it used to be. Our digestive tracts are not as good as they used to be. We have pesticide exposure and all these kinds of things that push us toward Th2. So it's common, very common, to see 3% eosinophils because we're all slanted that way. So IL-5 makes eosinophils. IL-4 drives B cells, plasma cells to make IgE, but notice the IL-4 also drives mast cells. And IL-13 drives mucus production and what they call out here, which is basement membrane thickening. Okay, another paper, same message, epithelial inflammation. You get these cytokines like we're talking about, and it drives mast cell degranulation, mucus production, Th2 dominance. Now, this is Nature Medicine 2012. The key to this paper is simply that you can get plenty of mast cell degranulation in a way that has nothing to do with IgE. It's not about the IgE. You can get it simply because of TSLP, IL-33, IL-25, and other kinds of things, even like induction by bacterial toxins. So patients with mast cell issues won't necessarily have IgE. And sometimes you'll see a clinician will say, well, I know there aren't any mast cells involved because their IgE level isn't high, and that's not correct. Okay, so everything that I've shown you so far should be reinforcing the realization that T cell polarization is at the center of this thing. So we go back here. So we've got this dendritic cell handing a fragment of antigen to a naive T cell. That determines what kind of T cell it's going to become, right? Depending upon what cytokines you see in that row, that's going to determine what kind of T cell you've got. That's going to determine the effector cytokines, and that's going to determine what kind of functions you have. So again, at the heart of the matter is the interaction between the cytokines and their receptors. Now, notice also the micromilieu, the authors call out, the micromilieu, vitamins, cytokines, histamine, adenosine, and so on, also play a role here. Okay, so this is simply a diagram from Wikipedia. You see a cytokine landing on its receptor, causing an intracellular response, where now you have elements that go migrating into the nucleus and influencing gene transcription. So that progression from cytokine to receptor stimulation to intracellular response to a migration of elements into the nucleus causing gene expression, that becomes the key sort of end effect of cytokine plus receptor, is what kind of gene transcription you get, what kinds of functions you're driving. Nature Reviews Immunology. So here's interleukin 6 stimulating the interleukin 6 receptor. So right away your ears should be perking up to the question of, does my patient have a gain of function for the production of IL-6? Does my patient have gain of function for IL-6 receptor? Here's IL-21 and its receptor. And so the question becomes, how much STAT3 expression you're going to have? If you have STAT3 expression, you're going to have STAT3 migrating to the nucleus, influencing gene expression. Gene expression of what? Gene expression of these Th17 cell effector cytokines. These are the cytokines that carry out the Th17 cell programming, which is autoimmune tissue destruction. Now, noteworthy, interleukin 27 in this diagram, but also IL-12 and particularly interferon gamma, will cause the expression of a different STAT, and you see how that will create inhibition of the STAT3's ability to create gene expression of the effector cytokines. And this is how Th1 inhibits Th17, is by blocking that effector cytokine expression. Okay, so if you don't get STAT3 landing in the nucleus creating the expression, you don't get the effector cytokines. Now, quick overview. This is blood 2008. Naive T cells will respond to the differentiation cytokines. That determines what kind of T cells they're going to become. Noteworthy that we don't think anymore that autoimmunity is part of Th1 response. In the immunology community, we think of that as a Th17 function. So now, we've got this differentiation cytokine pattern. The naive T cell is going to get influenced, and the key thing is going to be the individuality of cytokine expression and receptor expression, and the way that it pushes different kinds of T cell polarization emphasis. So cytokine plus abundance plus receptor efficiency equals strong signal, and it's going to be harder to move that patient back to normal, back to a balanced T cell polarization pattern. You're going to have to push them harder to get across that response threshold. Okay, so key functions. Th17 cells, as I said, drive autoimmunity. You might see neutrophil percentages go up, right? 68, 72, 74% neutrophils. You might see a high CRP, a high sensitivity CRP go up, not always. And also, a meaningful difference would be 2.5, which you wouldn't consider high, going down to become 0.3. You'd see that in a patient who's making progress. What about Th1 cells? They kill bacteria and viruses. They're associated with cancer surveillance. They're low in chronic infection. They inhibit Th17, so they quiet down the autoimmune process. If you see a total white count that's low, that may also require activation of Th1 from a therapeutic point of view. Th1 can be high if the monocytes are higher than 12%. You're usually going to see that in acute illness. Remember, we're talking about chronically ill patients. It's unlikely you'll see Th1 excess in a chronically ill patient. What about Th2? The normal function of Th2 cells is to kill parasites, expel pollen, and things like that. And hollow space inflammation drives Th2 dominance, like we mentioned. Eosinophils above 2, basophils above 0, mast cells, histamine, allergies, all that is going to make you think about Th2 dominance. What about regulatory T cells? Regulatory T cells quiet down all the effector T cell types. Everything that isn't a reg goes down. But too much of this kind of program, too much tolerance, can give you chronic infection. Because if you have too much tolerogenic signaling, you're not killing enough stuff. And high TGF-beta is where you may have trouble here. Okay? Both because it's tolerogenic and because it may be a signal that you've got that innate lymphoid cell type 2 process going on, pushing the MDSCs to make an abundance of TGF-beta. And this is common in chronically ill patients. So TGF-beta tells the naive T cell to become a regulatory T cell. That regulatory T cell then makes more TGF-beta. Okay, so key questions. Where are the patient's imbalanced inefficiencies, or imbalanced efficiencies? Are they recently developed? Are they baked in? Did the patient come upon being Th2 dominant, let's say, because they ate something that gave them food poisoning? And so you're seeing a person whose dysbiosis is recent, and it made their intestines deeply inflamed, but that doesn't reflect something that's genetically baked in. Maybe it's just a new thing. But on the other hand, is there evidence of something more baked in? You want to look in the history, you want to look in the labs, and you want to know what the genomic profile is. So you're going to look for triggers, sustainers, amplifiers. You're going to look for autocrine loops, right? Those cytokine loops like IL-4 for Th2 cells, IL-6 and IL-17 as drivers of Th17 loop activation, right? Those are going to be very important. The key imbalances, you want to watch for Th2 dominance, hollow space inflammation, hollow space inflammatory dysfunction, environmental or food intolerance, mast cell issues, histamine issues, and for Th17, autoimmune stuff. And then that autoimmune flare activation is going to be sharpened by something called Th22, which I'll show you in just a minute. So, now here's a key point. Wouldn't we want to just reduce inflammation first? Why don't we just do that? Well, the reason is, if you start by reducing inflammation, in a patient with T-cell polarization imbalances, you can make them worse, and I'll show you how. So the steps are, you want to spend the first couple of weeks rebalancing T-cell polarization, and that you want to sort of install that as a first layer. Then you want to install the layer where you're dampening down inflammatory activation, and then you want to personalize as a third layer. And it's not a sequence of the first thing, then stop, second thing, then stop, third thing. At the first layer stays. Second layer stays, and the third layer you add on top. Okay. Now, the Th2 dominance autocrine loop is interleukin-4 drives naive T cells to become Th2 cells. They make yet more interleukin-4. So that's already an autocrine loop where that interleukin-4 tells yet more naive T cells to also become Th2 cells. And you get all these effector functions. Now the problem is that the IL-4, if there's a bunch of TGF-beta around, is going to drive Th9 cells, which are like a nastier version of Th2, more mucus, more inflammation. So in a patient who's Th2 dominant, if you try to promote regulatory T cells and reduce inflammation, all of that stuff happens at the same time. The things you do to reduce inflammation promote tolerance, you get more TGF-beta. If you do that before you have inhibited the excessive Th2 dominance, then instead of quieting down inflammation, you risk getting Th9 cells. So tolerance is going to promote TGF-beta, and in the Th2 dominant patient, you get TH9 instead of quieting things down. What about TH17? Interleukin 6 gives you TH17 cells that make more interleukin 6, tell other naive T cells to become TH17 cells. Notice, though, that interleukin 6 is also here. And anything that promotes TNF-alpha in that whole inventory of the functional medicine patient, any of those things, when the person gets more inflamed, it's going to promote TH22 polarization. And the problem is that those TH22 cells will make interleukin 22. Now, why do we care? Here's why. Nature immunology. When you have TH17 cell activation, you're going to make interleukin 22 and interleukin 21. And if you've got a bunch of TNF-alpha and IL-6, you'll make the interleukin 22 also. Well, why do we care? Because it increases the glycosylation of your antibodies, and that makes autoimmune response nastier. For any given population of antibodies against your own tissue, the more glycosylated those antibodies are, the more aggressive they will be in attacking your tissue. So a patient with a thyroid peroxidase of 100 who isn't attacking the thyroid, if the flow of things increases glycosylation, their TPO, the thyroid peroxidase, the next time you measure it, could still be 100. But if those antibodies are more glycosylated, they'll be in the middle of an autoimmune flare. And we've all had this experience. Patient has a big flare of their Hashimoto's disease, and you think to yourself, I'm going to measure antibodies now. They're going to be much higher than ever before because of how bad this flare is. Nope, not necessarily. Sometimes. But sometimes the TPO or the thyroglobulin is no different than when they were dormant. The difference is the glycosylation. And so when you've got gain of function for IL-6 or the IL-6 receptor in a TH17 dominant patient, or even a patient who's kind of okay, if they get inflamed, and especially if they've got gain of function for TNF-alpha and for IL-6, some combination of those things, the likelihood of TH22 activation and production of IL-22 and the likelihood of that creating a sharper autoimmune intensity is much greater. So it becomes important to know about these SNPs in these patients. So IL-6 plus TNF-alpha, TH22, you're off to the races with your glycosylation and your antibody aggressiveness and your autoimmune flare. So the antibody numbers don't have to be higher. Now, this is a New England Journal of Medicine paper, IL-17, drives all these cells to make all these nasty things. And look at what you got. You got a bunch of IL-6, you've got the CRP, you've got TNF, you've got IL-1. Now you can see how nasty the TH17 response is. You get all these biological effects, and it drives all these conditions, psoriasis, other autoimmune diseases, and so on. All these nasty things that you see in practice. Notice also osteoclastogenesis. So when you see a patient with osteoporosis, you want to think about TH17. So back here, you've got IL-6 and its receptor, IL-21 and its receptor. You're going to drive STAT3 activation. You're going to drive translocation into the nucleus, gene expression of TH17. And again, what we're trying to do is create some inhibition of that, right? We want to get that blocking effect happening. Okay, so you can see this is a paper from 2008. We've understood about TH1 inhibition for quite a while. Here's Nature Immunology 2011. TH1 inhibits TH2, and TH1 inhibits TH17. Nature Medicine 07, TH17 drives sustained tissue damage. TH1 antagonizes TH17. Okay, so Tregs downregulate all the other kind of T cells. TH2 blocks TH1. TH1 blocks TH2. TH1 blocks TH17. So there are two ways to quiet autoimmunity. What we all think we should do first is promote Tregs, right? The thing is, you're going to get some inhibition of TH17, and that's good. But If you do that second, if you think about TH1 second, the problem is that when you promote your Tregs, you will squash TH1 and you will lose your inhibition of TH2 and you'll end up with more TH17. The proper order is TH1 first to squash TH17, do that first, then once you've got that supported, then you're going to promote Tregs, you'll further squash TH17. And you want to keep that TH1 response up while you're promoting immune tolerance. Okay, TH2 self-reinforcing activation, like we talked about, you get a naive T cell driving toward TH2, and the problem is that that TH2 cell makes more interleukin-4, tells other naive T cells to become TH2 cells. It's the interleukin-4 that inhibits TH1. You want to squash interleukin-4, okay? And of course, TH2 is involving all those kinds of things we talked about. Now, again, why do so many people have TH2 dominance? Here are some papers talking about the various ways that people become TH2 dominant. They're just going to flash on the bottom. You can, when you watch this over again, you can grab those papers. Stress downregulates TH1, promotes TH2. Mold and candida promote TH2. Pesticides promote TH2. Plastics, BPA, things like that. We all have residues of that in our tissue, promote TH2. Head injury promotes TH2. Sleep dysfunction promotes TH2. And inflammation in hollow spaces, like we talked about. All of that gives you TH2 activation. You squash TH1. When you squash TH1, you lose your inhibition of TH17, and you're off to the races with your TH17 dominance. If you promote Tregs first in this patient and further squash TH1, you will have trouble. The patient will do worse. Okay? You got to watch out for the things involved with TH2 dominance. The correct order, promote TH1, squash TH17, and then promote regulatory T cells, further squash TH17. Okay. Now, step one, you got to promote TH1, but also you've got to inhibit TH2 so that you can make progress with gaining ground with your TH1 promotion. So, rebalancing T helper cells is step one. Start that first. A couple of weeks in, you can go on to the next thing, which is inflammation autoimmunity coactivation, right? So step two is promoting Tregs because they're in a teeter-totter with TH17. So step two, after you've got T cell polarization of the TH1, TH2, TH17 type installed, now you can hit your Tregs, all the ways that you're accustomed to for downregulating inflammation. Okay? And all of those things turn out to be STAT3 inhibitors. So, rebalance T cells, address inflammation autoimmune coactivation, then you got to personalize. Common problems, right, like pathogen burden, you have to improve innate immunity, natural killer cells, things like that. What about low white count? You've got to increase white blood cell numbers and function. And what about dysbiosis? You have to heal the intestinal lining. And because, remember, GI inflammation is a promoter of TH2, inhibition of TH2 is part of that. Now, some people have a very pronounced TH2 dominance, and what they need is a particular focus on more of a push toward the inhibition of IL-4. What about higher histamine? You want to focus on two different things, one of which is inhibition of mast cell degranulation to get less histamine to be produced, and the second thing is you want to support clearance. All of these things are elaborated in the Cogent's immunology course. That course is sponsored by Pure. If you go to cogentsimmunology.com, that's the visitor homepage. If you click to join and enter that coupon code in the shopping cart, the cost of the course will go down from $3,000 to zero, courtesy of Atrium Innovations. There's a Pure Response group of products and educational tools that'll help you support healthy immune function. This is something that the folks at Pure and I worked very hard to design. So that you have some good products and good educational tools, I would certainly encourage you to look into that as well. Now, I want to turn it over to Dr. Nathan Morris, and he's going to talk to you about single nucleotide polymorphisms, related to some of these important cytokines.
Thank you, Sam. That, as always, was an amazing presentation. And I think the audience will find that what we're going to talk about next kind of fits hand in glove with what Sam brought up and some of those important cytokines. So I do have to give the disclaimer. I'm a paid medical advisor for PureCaps, and I am a founding member of the Pure Genomics team, and I have no other conflicts of interest to disclose. So nutrigenomics, the question is, why should I care? And that's something I struggle with sometimes trying to explain to my patients and sometimes to providers, because they don't understand that it can play a role in how we approach someone clinically. So the reason I think genomics are so important and nutrigenomics are so important, it's really understanding genetics that is the key to personalization in practice. So we can make assumptions about the mean, what the majority of people are going to look like, but those aren't a lot of the people that come into our practice. We're getting those people that are a little bit off the bell curve, and a lot of times that is because they're not taking the same environmental insults or the same intake of foods and reacting to them the same. And so that's really where genetics comes in, is that it's giving us some insight into how that person may be reacting a little bit differently from the average person. So here's a real simple example. You know, sometimes the difference between happy and sad can all lie in the genetics. And I've seen this many times, especially when it comes to something like making serotonin. And there is an enzyme involved here that can be slowed down called TPH2. And that's how we get dietary tryptophan to 5-HTP, which leads to serotonin. So that's just a very simple example of how individualizing care can be very helpful as we are meeting these patients and trying to find out where is our leverage point. So let's dive in. And sometimes genetics feels like this. It doesn't feel like a dive at all. It almost, you know, feels like a belly flop. But, you know, it's really not that difficult, because SNPs are really just the typo in genes. And these, and the wild type is what the majority of people in a population have, and the variant allele is what the minority have. And sometimes these variant alleles actually have a evolutionary advantage depending on the environment they're in. So just because it's a variant allele doesn't mean that it's always a disadvantage. In some cases, like we'll be talking about today, it can be a disadvantage, but in other cases, it can provide the ability to have better evolutionary survival. So why do these mistakes happen? And I kind of alluded to this. These aren't really mistakes at all. When we're looking at each individual person, the variants are who make me and who make you, if you would, that these are why I have brown eyes and brown hair, and why I can eat certain things and feel fine and not other things, and how I react to my environment that's different than you. But each of us have a lot of different variants, millions of variants, and this is not a bad thing. But in some cases, it can change people's clinical outcomes. So many SNPs, and what we're really talking about with SNPs, is a base substitution that changes, in some cases, not often, but in some cases, changes the actual protein. And in the case, in this case, normal, the enzyme is a normal shape and it's a normal function. With a SNP, sometimes that protein that's being read off the DNA has an altered shape and an altered function, and sometimes it's slowed down. But I want to, a lot of times when we think about SNPs, we're really thinking about SNPs that are not functioning as well. And this is where I would like to say, not so fast. Before we cross the street and say SNPs cause a slowing down, sometimes they speed up the enzyme. Sometimes it's a improvement of function of that that protein. And that's kind of where we're going to talk about today, some exciting new things we've brought into our platform, which are actually where we speed up the enzyme or speed up the production of things like interleukin-4, interleukin-6 receptor, and IL-17A, which y'all will recognize from Sam's previous talk, how important those can be. Also, we on our current on our previous report, we have IL-6, and that will continue to be there, as well as tumor necrosis factor, TNF. So those are some things that are really important to know if you are being more efficient in production. So the first one, and I think this is one of my favorites that we're going to be introducing, is interleukin-4, just because I'm seeing so many, seeing so much more involvement of mast cells, and this cytokine is produced by activated Th2 cells, as you remember, beta cells, mast cells, and basophils. And the SNP increases expression via enhanced promoter strength, and I'll show you what that means in a little bit. And here you can see, just to kind of reiterate where we're seeing this, and if you listen to Sam's talk, you know how important basophils, mast cells, and Th2 cells are. So if we're producing more of this, we're shifting more to the Th2 side of things. So it's estimated, it's not everyone that carries this, and it really, it only matters if you have both polymorphisms, and it's a TT genotype. And this is in 11.2% of the population, and it is a C to T transition. And it's when you have this, you're better able to attract a transcription factor that stimulates gene expression, which you can see here. This is the area that you're promoting. And so we're going to have an increased ability to have IL-4 expression. And you can see the global prevalence there. IL-4 stimulates the differentiation of naive helper T cells to Th2, which also produce more interleukin-4. So you can see the importance of knowing if this person has an increased tendency to produce this. And so some quick facts about IL-4. Its serum levels may rise in the presence of an environmental sensitivity. Blood levels are difficult to measure. And genetic markers provide insight into IL-4 expression. And sometimes that's all we have as a clinician, is the little clues that we can get. And that's where genetics really play a big role in my practice. So another one is IL-6 receptor. And the T allele alters IL-6 receptor peptide structure, which increases proteolytic cleavage of IL-6R into the extracellular space. And this is important because IL-6 can bind and act as a, this binding of the IL-6 receptor can be a inflammatory signal. And so this allele is in about 15% of the population, and it correlates with increased serum soluble IL-6 receptor, which mediates pro-inflammatory effects. So TT susceptibility to higher expression, 73% higher serum IL-6R in TT than CC. I think that's pretty important. That's a, if you see this in your genetic makeup, that's a pretty significant increase in interleukin-6R. So the other new addition is IL-17A. This one is located in the response element for NFAT, which enhances IL-17 expression. A allele increases IL-17 expression by increasing the affinity for NFAT. So you can see there in the picture the NFAT response element. And so it's basically going to increase production of IL-17 protein. And this happens in 11.2% of the population. So just some quick facts about interleukin-17, which kind of goes along with what Sam said previously. It's involved in immune activation, and it's important for natural defenses, but overactivation of IL-17 can lead us to other issues within the immune system, pushing more to that Th2 response. Also, IL-17 is important for the immune mediators IL-6 and tumor necrosis factor. We also, within our report, have IL-6 and TNF alpha polymorphisms as well that you will get there. Here's one that we haven't talked about a lot in immune, but I think it's really important, is the FUT2 with a risk variant AA. This is involved in the actual gut, and 20% of the population cannot secrete these antigens due to loss of gene function. And what this comes down to, they're called non-secretors. But when we have non-secretors, we have a lower diversity and richness of abundance of bifidobacteria. And what the research is really starting to show, the importance of bifidobacter are playing a big role in our immune modulation. So this is one I would always look at when I want to know, does the immune system need more support? I want to know about FUT2. So the question becomes, how do we get insight into genetics? And the good news is that Pure Encapsulations has developed a platform. Kelly Heim, who's a brilliant scientist, and myself developed Pure Genomics to help with clinicians understanding this information that it's readily available in 23andMe and Ancestry, but it just has to be interpreted so we can apply it clinically. So the things that I've talked about today and much more are available to you and your patients for free, both to the clinician and to the patient. And you can look at over 60 genetic variations, and we give insight into how nutrition is going to play a role. How supplements may be helpful, how lifestyle is going to be important. So it's not just here's a polymorphism, this is what you take, but this is how you would change your lifestyle, or this is how you would change your dietary habits. So it's a really helpful platform for the clinician to make clinical decisions, to understand better what they're seeing in their patients, but also it's really patient-friendly so they can look at it and they can go back and review it and understand what they can be doing to be more proactive in their health. So I appreciate being here very much and following Sam and his wonderful lecture. And I want to make sure to let you know that we're more than happy to take questions now. And if you will put those in, Sam and I will be glad to answer them. Thank you.